Hey Stargazers, welcome back. My name is Nick, I'm a theaters manager at the Adler Planetarium, and you're watching Skywatch Wednesday. Well, this episode we're going to continue to look at the springtime sky. Today we're going to look east at a very bright star. We'll also look at some of the dimmer stars around it as we inch closer and closer to summer. So, let's begin looking east a couple hours after sunset tonight. About halfway up in the eastern sky is the bright star Arcturus. We've mentioned the star in previous episodes as we used the handle of the Big Dipper to first arc to Arcturus and then speed onto Spica in Virgo, the Maiden. You might find that you spot Arcturus before you locate the Big Dipper. It's such a bright star and so prominent in the eastern sky right now. Arcturus is the fourth brightest star in the entire nighttime sky and the second brightest that's visible from mid-northern latitudes. Only Sirius is noticeably brighter from Chicago. It's just about the same brightness as Vega, which you can actually see at the same hour tonight, just rising in the northeast. It's also roughly the same brightness as Capella, which is currently low in the northwest. Both Vega and Capella are bluish-white stars. Arcturus, though, has a distinctive reddish-orange color to it. It's not nearly as pronounced as Betelgeuse in Orion, Antares in Scorpius, or Aldebaran in Taurus, but it's definitely noticeable, especially when compared to Spica, which is quite blue. Arcturus is a red giant star, roughly the same mass as our Sun, but around 25 times bigger. Earlier in its life, it would have been quite like the Sun, but as it's aged, it's exhausted its supply of hydrogen and has entered the red giant phase. Arcturus is the brightest star in the constellation Boötes, the Herdsman, or Plowman. Tracing out this constellation, some people see maybe an ice cream cone, others see a kite in the sky, with Arcturus near the tail of the kite. The Herdsman, or Plowman idea, originates from the ancient Babylonians, who associated this group of stars with the god Enlil, a patron of farmers. Some myths associated Boötes with the invention of the plow, and his handiwork is seen in the Big Dipper, also known as the plow. The name Arcturus comes from the ancient Greek, meaning the guardian of the bear, and one of the Greek interpretations of the constellation Boötes was as a bear guardian. It's most often associated with Arcas, a hunter who was about to unknowingly shoot his own mother Callisto, who had been turned into a bear. Zeus intervened and placed them both in the sky as Boötes and Ursa Major. Boötes is often shown holding the leash of two dogs, part of the constellation Canis Venatici, which is tucked under the handle of the Big Dipper. These two canines aren't to be confused, though, with the big and little dogs, Canis Major and Minor, the hunting companions of Orion. Arcturus was an important star to prehistoric Polynesian navigators. It was known as Hokulea, the Star of Joy. From the Hawaiian Islands, Arcturus shines directly overhead as it crosses the meridian. Traveling from Tahiti, navigators knew they had reached Hawaii's latitude when Arcturus went directly overhead at night, and they could then sail west on the trade winds to the islands. Returning to Tahiti, a similar system was used with Sirius as it passes directly overhead on that island. Arcturus also has an interesting Chicago connection. For the opening of the 1933 Chicago World's Fair, the light of Arcturus was focused on photoelectric cells at a number of observatories. This signal was converted to electric energy that was then amplified and transmitted to Chicago. When that signal was received, it was used to turn on the lights of the Century of Progress World's Fair. The signal from the star didn't actually power the lights, but apparently did provide the signal to turn them on. Arcturus was chosen because of its then estimated distance of 40 light years. The light reaching Earth in 1933 would have started its journey from Arcturus in 1893, when Chicago had last hosted a World's Fair, the World's Columbian Exposition. Arcturus is now known to be closer to 37 light years away, but the symbolism is still interesting. So give a look at Arcturus tonight, and for the rest of the spring and summer. The light you're seeing tonight left there sometime in 1984. As for myself, I was in diapers then, but for some of you perhaps there's some symbolism to look for. As far as easy patterns to look for in this part of the sky, some skywatchers look for a spring triangle of stars. This isn't as well known as the Summer Triangle or even the Winter Triangle, but if you connect Arcturus, Spica, and Denebola, the tail of Leo the Lion, you get a roughly equilateral triangle. Some skywatchers use Regulus instead of Denebola, making an eye-catching isosceles triangle. Well, if you're out a little bit closer to sunset, you've got a chance coming up to catch Mercury and Venus, along with the Pleiades star cluster. On the evening of May 3rd at sunset, look low in the west-northwest for bright Venus and above it slightly dimmer Mercury. Venus sets within an hour of sunset, but as it does, the sky will be getting darker and darker for the Mercury-Pleiades pairing. Binoculars will definitely help, and of course a very clear western horizon is a must. To the upper right of Mercury will be the Pleiades star cluster. Now Mercury's going to be putting on quite a good appearance in May, so we'll keep up to date on its appearance in the evening sky in the next episode. Sooner than that though, in fact tonight, April 28th, you've got a chance a little bit later on in the night to catch the waning gibbous moon near the star Antares in Scorpius the Scorpion. These two will be rising by about 10:30 here in Chicago tonight, and visible throughout the rest of the night. We're past the full moon for the month, so the lunar disk will be rising later and later in the night and getting thinner and thinner in phase over the next couple of weeks. The third quarter moon is on May 3rd, followed by the new moon on May 11th. So nice dark overnights in dark sky locations are going to be happening around then if you want to get out and see some very dark night skies. That's what we have for you this episode. Thanks, as always, for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to Adler's YouTube channel and also follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok. Happy stargazing, and we'll see you next time.